Now, allow me to invite Dr. Mohammed El-Rumaid, researcher and academic in marine biology and ocean science, to tell us about investigations on the pearl oyster resources of Bahraini waters.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. I'd like to thank DANAT for organizing this very important event. And I hope DANAT takes the initiative to reorganize this event in the coming years. Also, I would like to thank the audience, and I am very honored to stand before you to deliver my speech. The title of my presentation is, as you can see, Investigations on the Pearl Oyster Resources of Bahraini Waters. This investigation was actually carried out in the second half of the 80s, from 1985 through to 1990. However, now this project was, now it is already 3 decades after it is completed, but I think it is worth presenting our outcomes because they were unique. For two reasons, actually. One, this type of work was actually the first one of its kind at that time. Nobody from the Arabian Gulf did some or such project. The second thing, we were able to gather a lot of information regarding the biology of pearl oyster in this part of the world. And also, so the amount of information was tremendous. It was really heavy information. And that actually enabled us to establish a very full understanding about the pearl oyster resources in Bahraini waters. So all the information was actually fundamental, and they form a sort of baseline for any future scientific work in terms of comparison. So, okay. Before I go to the outcome of this project, I would like just to brief you very quickly about the animal, the organisms which produce pearls. Now, to start with, about the geographical distribution. Of course, as we all know, the pearl oysters occur around the world in the tropical and the subtropical region, like in the Indian Ocean, as you can see, Arabian Gulf, Red Sea, East Africa and Madagascar, Strait of Manar in India, Pakistan and Bangladesh. Also, they occur in the Indian Pacific Ocean, and Central America. This, strictly speaking, this figure shows the geographical distribution for the Pinctada radiata, the most dominant species in Bahraini waters. But we can, most of it, as we can see, as we have mentioned earlier, in the, from Central America all the way to the east coast of Africa. So this is the, even here we have some gray area, which is for actually Pinctada migratifera. The yellow square here highlights the pearl oyster around the Arabian Peninsula, in the Arabian Gulf and the Red Sea. So for the Red Sea, we can here see that in the Gulf of Aden, we have some pearl oyster beds, and off the coast of Djibouti, Farasan Islands off the coast of Saudi Arabia, and also the Dakhal Islands off the coast of Eritrea. So this is in the Red Sea. In the Arabian Gulf, actually, I would like to share with you this manuscript of pearl oyster beds around the Arabian Gulf. This manuscript was done by Bahraini Nokhide or Captain Ahmed bin Sayyid Abdul Ghafur, Ahmed bin Sayyid Khalifa bin Abdul Ghafur. He is from Al-Hid area, and this was actually published. Oops. in 1958. Okay, so it was published in 1958, and this shows how the Bahraini people were actually devoted to pearl fishery. This manuscript shows that all these squares are actually pearl oyster locations or pearl oyster beds from the coast of UAE, Qatar, Bahrain, Saudi Arabia, all the way north to Kuwaiti waters. Habitat and ecology of pearl oysters, of course, they occur in the shallow waters to a depth of approximately 20 meters with fresh water or terrestrial enriched waters. One of the facts about the good quality pearls of Bahrain is that the salinity is quite lower because of the spring wells in the offshore, so that actually decreases the salinity around the pearl oyster beds and make the water quality better for pearl formation with the results producing a better quality pearls. Sorry about this. Pearl oysters, they attach by bessel threads to a variety of substrata on rocky gravel and more rarely on sandy bottoms. Among recorded substrata are seagrass as well and clams of dead shells. I personally saw the spats, which are small oysters with maybe 1 centimeter length. They attach to a brown sea algae. As we know that they have right and left valve, and they sit on their right valve on the seabed at a degrees of 45 degrees to the attached surface. This is typically a picture of the pearl oyster beds. Here we can see it is mainly hard substrata with covered with a little bit of sand. So this is, you can see a group of oysters growing on each other. Here we have sea urchin. The diversity is very high. Here we have sea anemone with the clownfish. So this is typically the habitat we can see there. In terms of environmental factors, salinity and temperature, here in Bahrain we have that the temperature varies from 15 in the winter up to 37, 38, and sometimes maybe 40 in the summer. This is seawater temperature. Salinity-wise, in Bahrain, in the north and east coast of Bahrain, we have the salinity goes up to 45, yani 42, 45 ppt. Whereas in the west coast, it is actually 57 ppt. So it is 12 points. More than the east and north coast. We have noticed that the pearl oyster in the west coast, they are very small in size comparing with the oysters we found in the east and north oyster beds. We believe that maybe the salinity is having a great influence on the growth of pearl oyster in the west coast. Talking about the taxonomy, of course, all pearl oysters with commercial value, they are classified within genera Pinctata and Petaria. Okay, so here we have examples of those species which produce pearl on commercial basis. This is the Petaria penguin. And here we have this species complex, actually. This is Pigdata, Fucata, Martensi, Radiata, and Ibricata. This is, we call it the species complex. It is sometimes difficult to differentiate, from the morphological part of view. It is sometimes difficult to differentiate between Radiata and Fucata. So that's why it is called, it is considered to be a species complex. The morphology, they acquire quite the same. The other species, why I put it in within in this rectangular because and Pygdata fucata and or Pygdata megalatifera, they are the main known pale oyster in Bahraini waters. One of our colleagues actually did electrophoresis for pale oysters, and he found he could distinguish between seven species of pale oyster. But I mean, all the literature tells about the pale oyster in Bahrain. It is the Pygdata radiata. This is the Pygdata radiata, and this is the Magritifera. Pygdata radiata, shell length goes up to 70 millimeter to 80, 70 to 80 millimeter, which is half size of the Pygdata radiata, which grows up to 15 to 16 centimeter. This is in under Bahraini conditions. Maybe in other places, it can grow bigger due to lower salinity and maybe a better environmental condition, but it is there. Fouling organisms, because now though the pale oysters are actually, they are sessile, they are attached to their environment. They don't move very much, so they are basically, they are sessile. So that actually allow the other organisms to attach on them, because actually the surface is quite hard, is a bit hard, so, and rough, sorry, it is rough. With the results, it encourages the other organisms to attach and live on the on the shells. So here we have boring sponges, and this is sponges as well, and another species, and here we have a brown algae again growing on the pale oyster beds. And here we have examples of the fouling organisms which they grow on the shells, like the, and actually some of them they predate on oysters, so purposely to feed on them, and other organisms it is just like they use it as a substrata for their living. So we have here commensalistic relationship and what you call it, mutualistic. Example, you have here, so we have octopus, we have fishes, rays, and skates, and boring polychaetes, boring sponges, and boring, sorry, this is here, we have a mistake, boring gastropods. Boring gastropods. So all these boring stuff are actually, they are predating on the shell. They make a hole and on the oyster, oh, sorry, on the valve, and they pass through to the shell and feed on the meat. Another fouling organisms, the crabs and lobsters, they are also enemy to pale oyster, and also sea star. This photo here shows the mechanism by which the sea star predate on pale oyster. So first here, starfish, they have five arms, as we all know. So it surrounds the oysters, and eventually it cuts open the two valves, and then eat the flesh and leave the shell empty. And here we have some pictures of the pills, which are produced by the oysters. Here we have, this is natural pearls, and the rest are actually cultured pearls from different species. Now coming to the backbone of my talk. Before I start with this one, I have to say one thing here, is that actually the whole work we have done is actually initiated by His Majesty the King, King Hamad bin Isa Al Khalifa, the King of Bahrain. At that time, he was Crown Prince and Chairman for the Board of Trustees of the Bahrain Center for Studies and Research. His Majesty directed the Board of Trustees to conduct a survey on the pale oysters. His Majesty was very keen in reviving pale oyster, and that's how the whole thing actually kicked off. So as a story point, as our colleague Dr. Robert Carter just mentioned, Bahrain was the center for historic famous pearl fishery in the Arabian Gulf since time immemorial. Okay, and but after the oil boom, the fishery actually declined, and then after the cultural pearl as again it further declined, and all the way to the until the 80s, okay, where the 1950s, where the last fishing season of pearl fishing was actually stopped, maybe 53 or 55. I'm not sure exactly, but during the first half of the 50s. So the ex-Bahrain Center for Studies and Research actually, they taken the initiative to investigate whether the fishery could be revived as an additional source of income. So before we have conducted our comprehensive survey, a preliminary survey was conducted on the selected oyster beds. That was in August 1985. And then, of course, the purpose of that expedition was to determine about the status of pale oysters resources after 30 years from the last fishing season in the 50s. So this is the research vessel we have purchased, and it was actually equipped with the aqualung system and the navigational system. Okay. So the objective was actually to determine the size and density of the oysters population on the offshore pearl oyster beds, which were known previously in pearl fishery. To explore the frequency and occurrence of quality of natural pearls, to understand the environmental condition on the pearl oyster beds, and also to investigate producing pearls from natural beds through culture. We have during our work on the survey, we have also did some experimental work on pearl culture. And actually, we have succeeded in this technology. So now, before there was no major scientific work carried out in Bahrain on pearl oyster beds, and in order to achieve the goals which we have just mentioned, a set of programs were actually adopted. And so here we have a list, a survey of some of the important pearl oyster beds, studies on the yield and the composition of the pearl. So here again we have studied the difference in pearl content from different oyster beds. Spawning behavior of the pearl oyster based on the examination of gonadal smears and the plankton samples as well. Of course, the salinity, temperature, the pH, all these parameters were actually recorded because they are indication of other biological characteristics. A general study on the size, composition, distribution of oysters, and experimental studies on the spat collection technology. Now, during limitation of time, I will shed light on some of the items I have just mentioned earlier. Okay. So this is the main, you can see here in this picture, or in this slide, those are the oyster beds which we have mapped, which was one of the main outcomes of our survey work. We have dived in thousands of spots within these oyster beds. I would like to mention here that during our initial diving expedition, we used a diver who was working in the diving, who knows the places. He was actually guiding us to those oyster beds. And then, I mean, through the we have managed to dive in many in hundreds of stations, and we eventually produced this map of the oyster beds. Here we have the 12 oyster beds around Bahrain, which we have surveyed in the offshore water of Bahrain. Of course, they are another shallow, another locations for pale oyster in the shallow waters around Bahrain, which people until today actually they go and fish for pale fish, pale oysters in these shallow waters off the coast of Bahrain Island. So here we have Shigita. I have put the number for each oyster bed. Here we have Shigita, Buhagul, number 3 Al-Mayana, number 4 Bu'amame, Wulthame, Barkharab, and this is Busuwar. Number 8 is Baljal, number 9 is Rjale, and here we have Ishtaya. And this is Ibn Zayyan, and this is Al-Wadi. Now, Ishtaya, Bu'amame, and Wulthame, they are the marine heritage of the pale, the marine heritage of the paling path. So for the paling path, we have two parts. One is inland, which we have seen today, and the marine one, and those three, Shtaya, Bu'amame, and Bu'lthame. Okay, so in each diving activity, we used to calculate the time of the divers spending in the water. Normally, we used to dive for each diver used to dive for between 30 to 40 minutes, and each diver were requested to estimate the oysters in a quadrat of 50 by 50. Centimeter. So the timing was recorded, the density, and also counting the oysters collected at that time, diving time. Here we actually I give here example of the five oyster beds and the stock which we have estimated in each bit based on the locations which we had surveyed. Like example, in Awalthame, we have estimated the stock there to be 481, this is actually 1,000, not million. This is actually 1,000, sorry, this is a mistake. This is, should be 1,000. So Abu'amame, we have collected 481, and Awalthame, we have collected 428. Balyal 410, and Al-Mayana 360,000 oysters, and Balkharab 257, almost 258,000 oysters. I have mentioned before the Pingdata magnetifera. Now, out of those, I mean, thousands of oysters we managed to collect, we have only collected just one Pingdata magnetifera. Only one, and that was from Balkharab, from this oyster bed. So only one single individual shell of Pingdata magnetifera. Now, in terms of the pearl content, now this is the oysters, the oyster stock, the pearls. Now, what is the situation of pearls in Bahrain? Here we have, again, different oyster beds, and we have here the total number of oysters collected. Okay, this is the total number. And here the total number of pearls we have found in each oyster bed out of those oysters. And this is actually the percentage of pearl occurrence in those bits. So here we have in Belgial, this was the highest percentage, almost 8%. So out of 100 oysters, only 8 of them, they had pearls. And Bosowar, 5.6, or let's say 6, approximately 5. So it is all of them, they are actually low in percentage. This is in terms of quantity of pearls. If we go to the quality of pearls in terms of size, we can see here that, so again, this is the total number of oysters we have collected, almost let's say 2.1 million oysters from the 12 oyster beds, and the total number of pearls were 400 pearls. So actually most of the pearls we have found were less than 3 millimeters. The one with less than 1 millimeter and 1 and 2, which we call it in the local, it is locally known as sihtit. They actually, they are the dominant size of oysters, of pearls we have obtained. As a matter of fact, when we started our survey, we thought that we will get a very big number or big size of pearls. But unfortunately, what we have got was actually an opposite picture. So this is the thing. What about the bigger size pearls? This is the situation at that time. So 4% were 4% 3 millimeter, and the rest are actually we have found 9, 8, 7, 6, but maybe just 1 or 2 pearls. And all these big size pearls were actually found in those 3 oyster beds: Al Mayana, Bu'amama, and Belial. So this is the situation in Bahrain, and also we have recorded the same situation in Kuwait. In Kuwait, it was, and I would like to share with you the same, the same pattern of pearl occurrence. This is actually what happened in Kuwait. Again, most of the pearls are actually below or less than 3 millimeters. However, the methodology they applied in Kuwait, it is different than our methodology, but the pearl pattern is quite the same. Also, during our during the 80s, the Gulf region faced a number of oil spill incidents. So we thought that because actually we were monitoring the small size of pearls, and we were always thinking why most of them they are small size and we don't have the bigger size. So we thought maybe this is due to the water is polluted, the water quality is not that good. It doesn't help the oyster to produce a better pearl quality in terms of size. So we had to do some heavy metal or heavy metal analysis for the flesh of the pearl oysters, and we sent our samples to Kuwait Institute for Scientific Research, KISR. And fortunately, the results were actually were within the normal standard levels. So the pearl oyster were not polluted. And this is actually very logic, because if we have an oil spill, the oil actually floats in the sea, and the pale oyster actually 20 meter depth. So it is not unlikely to be affected from the huge amount of oil which is spilled into the Gulf. Okay, the last part which I am going to present is about the spat collection. We have conducted experimental study on the spat collection using the spat collection technology. Of course, the spat collection is a technology by which the very young spat oysters are actually collected from nature by providing a suitable spat seating material at the appropriate time and also suitable location. So those are the main criteria to catch a good quantity of spats. To use the right material and put it in the right place at the right time. Otherwise, the results won't be that good. Of course, in the countries where some mollusks are cultivated, like oyster or pale oyster or mussels, the spat technology is very good methodology to catch small size of pearls. Sometimes it is maybe difficult to rear the spats in the lab, because that's actually costly. Whereas in the spat collectors, using spat collectors from the low cost material, it can achieve a very remarkable results. So this technology affords a simpler and easier method of catching the young ones and growing them to adult oysters. And also it helps to raise a good stock of oysters. I will share with you the different materials which we have used. This is myself. Oops. This is me back in 1988. This is my my friend here, and this is actually this is the palm tree branches, local material and very cheap. Maybe we can get it even free of charge. So this is and here we have the oyster shell wren. It is actually a line where the oysters are actually put through with the small plastic hose, small plastic, just to provide more space in between the oysters. This is called oyster shell rim. Another material. By the way, we have actually, because it was experimental and we want to keep our spat collectors safe, we have used the Coast Guard checkpoint, one in Fisht al-Jarum and the other one on Khorfisht. This is in the north coast of Bahrain. This is another type of fruit basket, very simple plastic fruit basket, okay, all tied with a rope, and just hang it on the side of the checkpoint. This is a cement coated oyster cage, and also we put inside a net, okay, even to provide more space for the spat to first to the larvae, and then they grow to spat. This is another one. Oops. This is another material, frame wooden coated with bitumen, okay? And this is my colleague, Dr. Hashim Sayed. He was examining the spats on those material. Mm-hmm. Actually, when we put those collectors in the sea, we used to monitor them once every fortnight. And it was a very interesting experiment, and actually we have achieved a very good significant results. Here we have the location for where we have actually put the spot collectors. This is here in Fisht el Jarem Coast Guard checkpoint, and this is the Coast Guard checkpoint in Khorfesht. This is so in the north, and here we have in buoy number 3. This is in the navigational channel in and out of Bahrain waters. And again here we have another, we have modified a raft where we put it in the off the coast of Ras Hayyan area. So at the end of the day, actually we have managed to collect good information, and we have determined the best place, the best time, and the best type of spot collectors, and it was actually this one. See, this is the pale oyster or the pale oyster shell wren. Before this was in 28 July 98. And this is, see, it is full with the spats. Very full with the spats, and previews a number of spats. But this is 4 months after this one, 4 months. So actually, I mentioned before that one of the programs we have carried out is the determining the spawning season, okay? So this, this photo here, actually supports our findings, which we have got from the spawning season. The spawning season indicated that we have 2 spawning season for pale oyster, where at the time they released their eggs. One is quite a long period during summer, which goes from June through to September. And the second spawning season is quite short at this time, actually, in November, December. So this is actually, so to have this in October, it means that, and as I mentioned before, we used to keep monitoring. So maybe 2 weeks after we put this, by the end of July, so 2 weeks after, we started to find the small spats, maybe ranging maybe 1 to 3 millimeter, and from that time we used to calculate the or to measure the oyster bed, and actually that opened another study to study the rate of growth. The rate of growth of because we had gathered our information for 2 years, once every fortnight. So that was a good opportunity to study the rate of growth of pearl oyster. So this is what I could present out of that project in this 30 minutes, and I hope I have covered and give you a good information about that expedition. And thank you so much.